So let's look at inferential statistics in this thing called correlations. We'll talk about one more page of stats because it's important. These are not high-level stats. These are common stats that you should know something about because people talk all the time about correlations. I heard our governor talk yesterday on a show on NPR about you can make a direct correlation. His conclusion, I thought, was very good. But you've got to be careful when you use that word correlation. And you have to be very careful when you start making inferences. So what we've looked at up until now are called descriptive statistics. They describe your sample, right? They describe things like categories, demographics, for example. Who's in my sample? Older, younger, middle, income, race, ethnicity, politics, religion, geographical location. All of those things might have some impact on the way people perceive their world, and we would want to quantify those to the best of our ability to see whether we have a truly representative sample or not. And then we can look at things like a variable and see where that variable lies on a scale. Assuming that there's reliability and validity, we can now see what a mean might be and where the data might spread out in that data set in a way that is, I hope, more meaningful to you now. But now we go to another level where we want to infer things. Now, most people want to infer causality. They want to know what causes something, thinking that if they know the cause, they've pretty much summed up everything you need to know about something. But things are rarely simple in human affairs, right? Usually causes are complicated, but people don't want complicated. They want easy to understand, or they want to believe somebody else truly understands it in a way that nobody else can. So we look at correlations as one type of inferential statistic. So there are lots. Keeping that in mind, easy way to remember that to me is break it down syllables. Co-relations. Co-relationships. Correlation just means that two things are related to each other in some way or aren't in a way that you can actually see using a metric. Two or more variables being related to each other is what we're talking about, and the metric I'm talking about is called a coefficient, correlation coefficient, Pearson product moment correlation coefficient, et cetera, one tail, two tail. You don't need to know that for now. But don't be afraid of it either, because you can know it later if you don't already know it. So now I got a number that falls in the range of negative one to positive one. Negative one to positive one is not a very big range, but it's a very well-defined range, right? So we're talking about decimals now, yes? So as long as you know your negative one is the bottom boundary and your positive one is the top boundary, zero's right in the middle, then you know something about relationships when you see a correlation coefficient. When you see it, it'll look like this, R equals something. R is the little symbol they use in statistics to denote correlation coefficient. So don't be scared of it. It's just little r, should be italicized according to some publication manuals, and that's a convention that could change, as could changing what you use to symbolize it, but what it is will never change. R equals something between negative 1 and positive 1, right? So a perfect correlation is negative 1 or positive 1, and you'll never see one in psychology. Because it means if you graph it out, then it's a unit for unit increase in one equals a unit for unit increase in the other without fail, right? Or a unit by unit increase in one equals a unit by unit decrease in the other without fail. Nothing in the realm of humanity and human experience is that straightforward. Height and weight are positively correlated. The taller you are, the tends to be the heavier you are. But they're not correlated at a 0.1 level or a 1.0 level. It's not a perfect correlation because there's other factors, other causal factors, right? How much one eats, how much one exercises, what one fat ratio or muscle mass might be. Things of that nature. Bone density even, right? It's not just height equals weight. That's not a perfect correlation. We've already talked a little bit about probability, and I want to emphasize it here. Probability is statistical significance. Remember we were talking the other day about statistical significance. How do I know that if you give me a correlation coefficient, that that's not just randomly due to some kind of chance pattern of data that I happen to get? Well, I'll have a p-value associated with it. P is probability. It's nothing to be afraid of, right? Nothing to fear. P just tells us whether I want to take this really seriously or not. So if you say, well, these two things are correlated, an informed consumer of statistics will go, well, what's the p-value, right? Because if it's above, in social sciences, 0.05, we would say that's not significant. It's not statistically significant. Well, if it's not statistically significant, then we don't even need to worry about whether it's practically significant or not, because it's the same thing as saying we don't know if they're related or not. So a p-value is going to give me a range that falls within 0 and 1.0. So it can't be better than 0.00000, and it can't be worse than 1.0. People look at that and they don't really understand it, but I think it's pretty simple if you explain it properly. If I have a p equals 0.01, then what I'm saying essentially is that one time out of 100, that data set could have been generated randomly. You see what I mean? Probability is that 99 times out of 100 it wasn't. It's a real pattern that exists in real life that we captured by what we measured, right? We've got measurement error. Everybody's got measurement error, but more so in the field of human experience. We accept p.05 as saying that's significant. If it's below 0.05, then we call it significant. The lower, the better. If it was p.001, that means one time out of 1,000 this might have happened by chance. Meaning 999 times out of 1,000, it didn't happen by chance. It's very likely to be real. We would then want to replicate it and see if it still holds. If it does, then we have more confidence in our conclusions, right? We accept p.05 not because we're loosey-goosey with the stats, but because what we measure is difficult to capture in hardcore metrics. You think they're going to accept a p.05 in engineering or in physics? 5 times out of 100, the bridge might fall down. I don't know. Let's build it. Hardly. We wouldn't want that, would we? But the forces they're measuring are highly quantifiable forces. Yes? That's why they're called hard sciences. It's hard data, right? You know what mass and density and things of that nature are, right? Those things are very quantifiable. We have instruments that allow great precision in measurement versus self-esteem. Where's your self-esteemometer? Right? You have to measure that in some way that is both reliable and valid, and we do, but there's a lot more play in the metric itself than, say, weight. If I have a properly calibrated scale, and that makes a difference whether it's properly calibrated or not, it's going to give me a very precise reading. But there is no such perfect scale for some other kind of thing like aggression or intelligence or self-esteem. I can take tests of things. I can test your mathematics ability, right? But it's not going to be a perfect test. So there's going to be some measurement error in it. And that's why we accept p.05. Because if you can find it and replicate it, it probably exists. If the p level is less than 5 times out of 100, it could have happened by chance. So of course, we're looking for true significance to be lower than that. Certainly replicable, but that's where we arbitrarily cut our line. Some other sciences might go as high as 0.10, but we don't. As a standard, as a science, 0.05 is our bottom level. If it's a 0.07, you might go, well, it seems like it's trending towards significance, but it's non-significant. We don't treat it as though that's a finding that you can hang a hat on. It's possible, so you should replicate and check your design. A negative correlation gives you the direction of the relationship. The direction of the relationship is what we're talking about when we say positive or negative. We're going to use the words positive and negative in psychology a few different ways. So keep in mind when we're redefining different terms how we're using the terms. Here we're using them really as a direction indicator, but it's also mathematical. In a way, positive correlation, negative correlation is a metric. It's a mathematical concept, right? But at the same time, what we're really looking at is the R value. Is the R value negative or is the R value positive? If the R value is negative, it means as one variable goes up, the other variable goes down. Right? So you look at things like the economy, right? As the consumer price index goes up, maybe unemployment's going down, but are those things causing one another to move? Probably not directly, but they have some kind of relationship. It may not be a strong relationship, which takes me back to the correlation coefficient. If it's zero, that means there's no relationship at all. If positive one is a perfect positive correlation and negative one is a perfect negative correlation, then a zero means there's no relationship. So now what we're talking about is that, assuming there is one, what direction does it indicate the variables are related in? Correlated variables. So as temperature goes up, wearing of coats goes down. Well, I can measure temperature with great precision, but now we're into the realm of human behavior. Measure coat wearing, and what you find is you need a really good operational definition of coat, right? Because some people go, well, a hoodie's not really a coat. Was a sports jacket a coat? Are we talking about ski vests? Are we talking about a vest with no sleeves? You could get into some debate over what a coat is. But one thing we could do is once it's decided, is decide that's our metric for coat wearing, and we could sit there and videotape people if we were going to be really careful about it and have them code how many people coming in the door are wearing coats today. Right? But there's going to be some people like my daughter who, when she was in high school and it was freezing cold outside, would want to wear a tank top and flip-flops. And I'd be like, that's crazy, girl, don't wear that. She's like, it's not cold outside. Because her human experience defined cold different than mine. Hers was more fashion-driven, and mine's more comfort-driven. Right? So it turns out that people don't do things with perfect predictability, which is why we have measurement error. But if we can say that we can measure it with reliability and validity, then I can determine how many coats are worn on any given day. I can look at the temperature on any given day, and what I'll see is a negative correlation. As temperature goes up, coat wearing goes down on average. As temperature goes down, coat wearing goes up on average. That's all that means. Most people don't know what it means, so they just kind of glaze over when people start talking stats. Don't glaze over. A positive correlation is a similar idea. But now we say if the R value is above 0.00, toward positive one, then it's a positive relationship. So as one variable goes up, the other variable goes up. As the temperature goes up, ice cream sales go up. Right? As the temperature comes down, people stop buying as much ice cream. It's not a one-to-one relationship because buying ice cream is not caused by the temperature, right? But there are clear trends in people's behavior that we can relate to the temperature. So when we say a direct correlation, that would be a direct correlation. What it doesn't tell us is what variable causes the other or whether some other variable is at play. And that's an important distinction. Correlation does not equal causation. It only indicates whether a relationship exists between the two variables. And that's important, and as an informed consumer of statistics, you want to know that and ingrain it in your head. Because as temperature goes up, ice cream sales go up. You know what else goes up, especially in heavily populated urban environments? Physical assaults go up. So if you look at it, as ice cream sales go up, physical assaults go up. As ice cream sales go down, physical assaults go down. So if you're coming from a fairly ignorant point of view, and when I say ignorant, it's not stupid, it means if you don't understand it, but could understand it, you would go, wow, one thing related to another thing, if I know what happened in time first, that must have caused the other thing. That's contiguity in space and time. We see things, if I kick that, well, I kicked it first and it went flying second, so the kick must have been the cause of that. But when we're talking about complicated human experiences, causation is not so straightforward as that. Nobody in here thinks that ice cream sales cause assaults, and certainly assaults are not causing ice cream sales. And there's a third variable at play called temperature, but even that's not directly causing. If it's really hot, is it going to make you beat somebody up? No. But some people might be more inclined to become aggressive in uncomfortably hot conditions, where other people would be less inclined to become aggressive in uncomfortably hot conditions. And then might go down because people aren't going out. When it's cold, 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 people aren't out and about. So there's a relationship, but correlation does not equal causation. I saw on the news a perfect example of an informed citizen. It just delighted me because I have a hard time watching some of the person on the street interviews that they try to pull out of their butt on the spot where they say, here's a little something happened. What do you think? And the person goes, that's good, or that's bad. And you go, well, that really added a lot to my understanding of the situation, right? It was a study that showed that kids who were in daycare more prior to school had more behavior problems in their school years. Now, preschool precedes school years. The logical assumption, if you're not sophisticated with your stats, is that, oh, being in preschool a lot means you're going to have more problems in socializing as a kid in elementary school. And they went to the person on the street and said, what do you think about this? And clearly they were gunning for a, well, I don't know, my kid's in daycare and I don't know what I should do now kind of response. And she said, well, I mean, one thing doesn't necessarily cause the other. I mean, there's a lot of reasons that people might be in daycare for longer or shorter period of time. It probably has something to do with quality of daycare too. I don't know. But it's probably a little more complicated than that. She didn't say it quite like that, but she said something to that effect, and I was just like, yeah, that's it, that's right. You can't draw a conclusion from that about causality. Don't even be duped into thinking you can. You could make some reasonable inferences about possibilities, but you can't conclude without an experiment. And to do that, you would have to randomly assign kids into higher and lower levels of not only daycare in general, but higher and lower levels of amount of time and amount of quality. So are you going to put a kid in a bad daycare? Thank you, sir. Just to see what the effect will be? I mean, you know it's bad. You are going to design a study to put a kid in a bad experience to see what the outcome is? No, you're not going to do that because it's not going to be ethical, and therefore you're not going to be able to test that with an experiment, and you're not going to draw a conclusion that is in concrete. Right? I hope y'all see the value of this, because now we're moving on to biological foundations of behavior.